गुड मॉर्निंग स्टूडेंट्स.
गुड मॉर्निंग मैम.
वन गूगल फॉर्म आई हैव सेंड टुडे मॉर्निंग. फिल अप ऑल ऑफ यू फिल अप दिस फॉर्म एंड इन प्लेस ऑफ क्लास यू मे राइट योर सेम एंड ऑल्सो योर बैच वन. सो इफ यू हैव रिटन सेम First same, then okay. No problem.
Ma'am, in section, can we write F?
No, batch one.
Okay, ma'am.
Ma'am, I've already written F section and submitted.
Already written F. What is always written in your... Actually, F1 and F2, I was writing earlier. Okay, and remember, I was writing two by F section F. So F1 for batch one and F2 for batch three. But actually, in practical, you have F3 also. Then the problem arised. Now I converted that your section F to batch one, and it was the suggestion of the students that it is confusing with that lab F1, F2, F3, and that batch of theory class F1 and F2. Theory F1 means from 1 to 45, but in lab F1 means different, you know it. So it was confusing. So for that, I wrote batch 1. So why you have written then F?
Ma'am, in the morning you have sent and you have told to fill the form, ma'am. So I filled it at that moment
only. Okay, always when I write in, I send link, then what I write there? Section F I write or batch 1 I write?
And batch 1.
Then?
Ma'am, but actually once there was written that information technology, the section is F, so that's why we have written F.
Whatever information I will want later, so write there batch 1. Otherwise, you will be confused with your that second batch F2.
Okay, ma'am.
Data is there, na? F1 and F2 total data is there. So section batch 1 and batch 2. Then you will see your data maybe in that second section.
Okay, ma'am. Ma'am, changed.
And two different teachers are taking the classes, you know.
Ma'am, so we again fill the form, ma'am, with correction.
No need. So whatever form I will give letter also, okay. So I don't know, yet I don't know what will be the type of the class test and when will be the type of class test. I have no notice today, yesterday and today also. So if I get any notice about the class test, I will inform you all. But if I take the test or anything or assignment there, in Google form or anything, if I send to my batch, that is batch 1, they are always write batch 1. Otherwise, your marks, internal marks, your assignment will be confused later with that batch 2. Understand? Where you are, you have to write section F, that you will decide for the other classes, rest classes. But for physics, for my class, whatever information I will want, they are write only batch 1. Roll number 1.
Yes, ma'am.
Roll number 2.
Present, ma'am.
3.
Present, ma'am.
4.
Present, ma'am.
5.
Present, ma'am.
6.
Present, ma'am.
7.
Present, ma'am.
8.
Present, ma'am.
9. Roll number 9. Roll number 9. Absent. 10.
Present, ma'am.
11. 11.
Ma'am, 11 is absent.
12.
Present, ma'am.
13.
Present, ma'am.
14.
Present, ma'am.
15.
Present, ma'am.
16. 16.
Present, ma'am.
17.
Present, ma'am.
18.
Present, ma'am.
19.
Present, ma'am.
20.
Present, ma'am.
21.
Present, ma'am.
22.
Present, ma'am.
23.
Present, ma'am.
24.
Present, ma'am.
25.
Present, ma'am.
26. 27.
Present, ma'am.
28 is absent. 29.
Present, ma'am.
30.
Present, ma'am.
31.
Present, ma'am.
32.
Present, ma'am.
33.
Present, ma'am.
34. 34. 35.
Present, ma'am.
34. Roll number 34 again calling. Absent. Roll number 34. 35.
Present, ma'am.
36.
Present, ma'am.
37.
Present, ma'am.
38.
Present, ma'am.
39.
Present, ma'am.
40.
Present, ma'am.
41.
Yes, ma'am.
42.
Yes, ma'am.
43.
Present, ma'am.
44.
Yes, ma'am.
45.
Present, ma'am.
46. Sorry, 45 up to. So, roll number, again calling the absentees. That is 9, roll number 9. Roll number 11. Roll number 28. Roll number 28 and roll number 34. So four students are absent today. Nine, 11, 28 and 34. Yesterday I discussed about the Fraunhofer diffraction. See, so two lenses are used here for Fraunhofer diffraction. So why can anyone say why the first lens is used? First lens is used here. What are the conditions of Fraunhofer diffraction? First, tell me first. What is the main condition of Fraunhofer diffraction? Say anyone. Source and the
source
it is already
and the screen both effect in finite distance.
So finite distance or infinite distance?
Infinite distance.
Source of light and the screen. So source of light and the screen at infinite distance. So how you will actually put source in at infinite position actually, is it possible? No. So what we can convert? We can convert the light coming from infinity. So source is at a finite distance, okay. So here you can measure the distance, but how you will make the source at infinity? That means the light is coming from infinity. That is the action of this lens. So this light, after passing through this lens, the light seems to be coming from infinity, parallel rays of light. So what is the action of this lens? So where you will put this lens? So that here you will get the light. It seems the light is coming from infinity, coming from infinite distance. Where you will put this lens? Think about your 11 and 12 class. This lens is used. To create light rays, parallel rays here, after passing through the lens. And it seems that the source is at infinity. So this lens is acting like this. So when from a point source, light is coming to this convex lens, then what is happening after passing through the lens, you are getting parallel rays, and that rays seems to be coming from infinity. So infinity coming from infinity means the source is at infinity. Now this ray will come to this after passing through the aperture, the light passes through this, the diffraction after passing through the aperture, you will get the diffraction pattern. And this lens is used to focus all the rays at this screen. The second lens is used for this purpose, to focus the diffraction pattern at this screen, on this screen P. Who is Abhishek Choudhury? Roll number. Who is Abhishek Choudhury? What is your roll number?
Ma'am, roll number 9.
Why? Why are you late?
Ma'am, today late, ma'am.
Sorry. Huh? So I want to know that. Oh, another. I am logging here. Logged in 2 times. Is it? So 44 is showing for that purpose. Oh, 2 times I'm here. So 3 students are again absent. So 9 is not absent today. So 9 is present. Okay. So 11, 28 and 34. These are the list of the absentees. Now coming here, this is single slit diffraction, intensity of single slit diffraction. Now let a plane wave front of monochromatic light of wavelength lambda a plane wavefront of monochromatic light of wavelength lambda be incident normally on a narrow slit AB. So AB, you can see this is the slit. This is A position and this is B position. Say this is the slit. So this is the slit. So different portions are written as A1, A2, A3 and up to AN, but the total slit is AB of width B. So you can see the width. What is the width of the slit from this position to this position? This is the slit width. So this is the slit width from this position. Note the cursor is where. This is from this position to this position. This is total width is B. So AB is the slit, narrow slit, and its width is B. Now, a plane wavefront of monochromatic light of wavelength lambda be incident normally on the narrow slit AB. So you can see the light. And from where it is coming, this light, I just mentioned, after passing through the, which? These rays? Think the previous figure, which I was discussing. The starting of Fraunhofer diffraction. At the starting of Fraunhofer diffraction, from where you are getting this light?
Yes, ma'am.
From where?
Infinity.
After passing through this lens. After passing through this lens. The light, after passing through this lens, this is the type of the light. This is the light. And it seems to be it is coming from infinity. So the lens I have not drawn here, the first lens, there are actually the two lens, here one lens and here is another lens. So so after passing through that lens, so light, that wavelength is lambda, it is coming to the narrow slit AB whose width is B, and it is coming that is slit width B placed perpendicular to the plane of paper. Now we have to calculate the intensity distribution due to the diffraction on the screen XY. So you can see this is the screen X and Y. This is the screen. So we have to calculate the intensity distribution due to the diffraction on the screen XY placed at the focal point of the lens L. So this screen XY is placed on the focal point. So this is the second lens actually. But as it is only single lens is drawn in this figure, so I'm not only considering this lens L and written as L. So L is the lens where, so L is the lens used here, and XY screen, it is placed at the focal point of the lens L. So this is the focal point of this lens, and here the screen is placed. We assume that each point on the slit, and remember student, every student remember this one. There is single slit diffraction, then double slit diffraction, and then n number of slit diffraction or grating. I will discuss one by one. If you can't understand this one, then total diffraction you will not understand. So this lecture is very, very important. So if you miss this class and if you don't understand this class, then the rest of diffraction you will not understand. So listen very carefully. So we assume that each point on the slits, on this slit is a source of secondary wavelets. So each point, what are the points? Say A1, A2, A3, AN. So these are different points. So each point on the slit is a source of secondary wavelets. So the light is coming to this direction. And here, each point on the screen is the source of secondary wavelets. Interference takes place between the wavelets. So interference takes place between the wavelets originating from such secondary sources. So these are all secondary sources. So from this point, light is coming in this direction. And from this point, it is diffracted. From this point, the light is diffracted. From A3 point, the light is diffracted. From AN points like this, the light is diffracted. So these all points, so each point on the slit is a source of secondary wavelets. Interference takes place between the wavelets originating from two such secondary sources. So this is the secondary source. A1 is one secondary source. A2 is some secondary source. A3 is another secondary source. So it is the light. Actually, this dotted line. Actually, this dotted line, if there is no diffraction, this will be the path. But after diffraction, this is the path and this is the angle theta. So each point on the slit is a source of secondary wavelets, and interference takes place between the wavelets originating from two such secondary sources. So you can say this light, it is diffracted and it is coming to this lens L, and after this, it is coming to this point P on the screen, XY. And also this light, it is coming here in this direction, and after passing through the lens, it is meeting in this direction. So interference is occurring here. So interference between what? Interference, each point on the slit is a source of secondary wavelets, and interference takes place between the wavelets originating from such secondary sources. So interference are occurring between the two rays, between this ray, say this ray, and these all rays are occurring from these secondary sources. So from secondary sources, all the diffracted rays are interference is taken between these rays, and that pattern we can see here. So interference takes place between the wavelets originating from two such secondary sources. This is first assumption. And number two, the slit consists of a large number of point sources. And here the large number of point sources are here. So A1, A2, A3, up to N. So large number of point sources, and each point source are acting as a source of secondary wavelets. Now, if delta be the separation between any two point sources, so delta be the separation, you can see the delta. Delta is shown between the distance between A1 and A2. Okay. So delta be the separation between the two points. So what is the distance between A2 and A3? What is the difference between A2 and A3? See? If A1 and A2 separation is delta, then A2 and A3 delta, A3 and A4 delta, A4, A5 delta. So in this way, so equidistant points. So in this way, what we can write, total width. The total width was B. So B is the sum of this delta. Say this is delta, this delta, then this delta, delta plus delta plus delta plus delta in this way. So as there are n number of points, so what will be the total width B? So remember this. This is n minus 1 into delta. Because if you have 3 points, So this is the say, this is B, this is distance B, this is A1, say some points, this is A2, this is A3, this is A4. Each distance is delta, this distance, each is 3. So what is B here? What is B?
3 delta.
Okay. That means delta plus delta plus delta. So actually, how many point sources are here? A1, A2, A3, and A4. How many?
Four
points. But you are writing here 3. Because here there were n number of points. So an was there. But what you have to write here, n minus 1. Why I have written 3? Because this is what? This is B equal to what? 4 minus 1 into delta. Okay. 4 minus 1 into delta. Because we have 4 sources. We have 4 point sources. 1, 2, 3, 4. But what is the gap in between? One, then two, three. So the gap between these two is one. This is one gap. This is another. This is another. So actually three. So four sources, if there are four point sources, we will write it B equal to 4 minus 1 into delta. So in the same way, I have written B equal to N minus 1 into delta, where N is the number of point sources. So here actually the diffraction pattern, you can show here, that is shown here. This is the principal maxima, maximum intensity, then all are maxima. This is secondary maxima. These are all the secondary maxima, but you can see the intensity is decreasing. The intensity is here. It is more than this. And all at these points are minima. This point is minima. This point is minima. This point is minima. This point is minima. And this is principal maxima. So this principal maxima is occurring here. The diffracted ray is this diffracted ray. And this is another diffracted ray. So this diffracted ray, that is undeviated ray. So undeviated, no diffraction occurs here. So you can see it is going straight forward. And here, this is the diffraction at an angle theta. So if this one and this one, it meets here, then this is the principal maxima. And the diffracted rays are here shown. This is one diffracted ray. This is another. In the same way, in this direction also different diffracted rays. And they are meeting in this point. So this is gives the secondary maxima. As the point P on the screen here, see. As the point P on the screen, this is the point P on the screen, is at a large distance from the slit. So this point P is a large distance from the slit. The amplitude of the secondary waves from A1 and A2 will be nearly same. So it is large distance. P is at a large distance from the slit AB. So actually B is not mentioned here. So you can write it here as AB. So I have different taken points. So it is written A1, A2, A3 and up to N. So this point is actually B. So whenever you will draw it yourself, you will write it B. So is as the point P on the screen is at a large distance from the slit, the amplitude of the secondary waves from A1 and A2 will be nearly same. So the amplitudes of the wave from A1, A2, they are nearly same. A1, A2, A3, they are nearly same. If the diffracted rays from A1 and A2 makes an angle theta, so you can see the diffracted ray from A1, this is the diffracted ray from A2. They makes an angle theta. So this angle theta, this is the angle theta. And if you see here one perpendicular, if you draw, and this angle is also theta. So with the normal to the plane of the slit, then the path difference between A2 and A2 dash, this is delta sine theta. See here, this is important. A2 and A2 dash is delta sine theta. So this is A2 and this is A2 dash. You can see. This is A2 and this is A2 dash. This is delta sine theta. As this angle is theta, according to that here, if it is delta, then A2 and A2 dash, this is delta sine theta. This is the delta sine theta. Remember, this distance is delta. And according to the triangle, that is A1, A2 and A2 dash, consider this triangle, A1, A2 and A2 dash, we can write that A2, A2 dash, this is equal to delta sine theta, where A1, A2 is equal to delta. Hey, ektu aste. A1, A2 is delta, and A1, A2, A2 dash, this is delta sine theta. The corresponding phase difference is phi, that is equal to 2 pi by lambda into delta sine theta. So the corresponding phase difference phi, if the phase difference equal to 2 pi by lambda into path difference, you know it, phase difference equal to 2 pi by lambda into path difference. Now the path difference between the two rays, see, this is the ray. This is the path difference. So we can start. That means what is the difference between the rays between A1 and A2? If you draw this perpendicular, then this distance from this distance to this is same. And if this distance and this distance is same, but this is extra. This distance A2, A2 dash is extra with respect to this ray, first ray. तो फर्स्ट रे इट इज दैट इट इज गोइंग इन दिस डायरेक्शन हियर एंड दिस रे इज गोइंग इन दिस डायरेक्शन नाउ व्हाट आर द डिफरेंस बिटवीन द टू रेज देयर इज द डिफरेंस ऑफ पाथ सो एक्स्ट्रा पाथ इज हियर व्हाट इज द एक्स्ट्रा पाथ हियर फॉर द सेकंड रे द एक्स्ट्रा पाथ इज a2 dash सो द फेज डिफरेंस बिटवीन द टू रेज पासिंग थ्रू a1 एंड a2 व्हाट इज द फेज डिफरेंस 2 पाई बाय लैम्डा इनटू पाथ डिफरेंस दैट इज डेल्टा sin theta Now the field at P due to the disturbance at A1. So the field we have to calculate at P due to the disturbance from A1. What is that field? E1 equal to, we can write it, say this is, I'm writing, this is AE10 sin omega T. Similarly, the field P, so see here, this is the amplitude portion. And this is same here for everyone, everything. This is same. So for every, from every, the field, we are going to calculate the field at P. So the field of P due to disturbance A1, this is this. Then the field at P due to the disturbance A2 equal to what? This portion, the amplitude portion is same. Because we have taken this, that is the amplitude of the secondary waves from A1 and A2 will be same. So the A1, A2, A3, for all this, the amplitude portion is same. So I am writing as E1 equal to, say this amplitude into sin omega t, then E2, due to the disturbance for A2, from A2 it is this amplitude, then again sin omega t plus phi. So phi is the phase difference between the first two rays. Phi is the phase difference. In this way, it will, you can write E3, E4, E5. And at last, what you will write? En. So for an end point, you can write it as En equal to, here E10 sine omega t plus n minus 1 into 5. So this is the field at P due to the disturbance of coming from an point. Now, these are all fields, the expression of. Now, we have to take the sum of this because we have to calculate the summation of this. Total electric field is the sum of the each individual contribution. So, we have individual contribution. The field at P due to E1, this is E2 is the field at P due to A2 point. Then, in this way, the field will be there from A3 for A3 point. Now, after for N point, the field at P is En. So this is this. Now we have to take the sum. Now this is totally mathematics after this. So we are going to calculate the field. So E equal to E1 plus E2 up to En. So this is the sum. So this amplitude is same. So I have written it at the starting. Then sin omega t plus sin omega t plus phi in this way up to sin omega t plus n minus 1 phi. So only the sum you have to calculate. So put it equation number 1. Now using the property, so which property I have used here? Cos A minus B minus cos of A plus B equal to 2 sin A sin B. So this is the formula that I have taken. So cos of omega t minus 5 by 2 minus cos of omega t plus 5 by 2. So what is the formula? 2 sin A sin B, so omega t minus 5 by 2. This is A minus B, consider this. Omega t is A and 5 by 2 is B. So cos of A minus B minus cos of A plus B. So this one. So what is the formula? 2 sin A sin B. So 2 sin A. A means what? Omega T. And B is what? 5 by 2. 2 sin A sin B. So 2 sin omega T sin 5 by 2. Again, this one. Cos omega T plus 5 by 2 minus cos of omega T plus 3 pi by 2. That is equal to what? In the same way, we can write 2 sin A sin B. So I have written like this. Now take the sum. Now take the sum. So you can, if you take the sum in left hand side, you can see this here it is minus sign and here it is plus sign. Cos of omega t plus 5 by 2 and here it is minus cos of omega t plus 5 by 2. So these two cancels. So these two will cancel and here cos omega t plus 3 pi by 2 and cos of omega t plus 3 pi by 2. So these two will cancel. So in this way, if you take the sum, then all these points, these terms will cancel with each other. So in this way, we can write up to nth term. So cos of omega t plus n minus this term minus cos of this equal to 2 into again sin A sin B. So this is sin, this is A term and this is the B term. So A and B, so cos of A, so this is the term. It is written like this. So now adding all the terms, we will get the terms because it will cancel. If we add all these terms here in the left hand side, this term will cancel. Cos omega t plus phi by 2 plus cos omega t plus phi by 2 will cancel with minus cos of omega t phi by 2. Then cos of omega t plus 3 phi by 2 will cancel with this term. So in the left hand side, what remains? It remains, if you just, what you have to do, you have to take one pen and paper and you have to calculate yourself. Now cos of omega t minus phi by 2 minus cos of omega t plus n minus 1, this term equal to what? 2 into sin phi by 2 sin omega t. Now here in the right hand side, what you are coming in this right hand side, you can see 2 sin omega t term, 2 sin phi by 2 term is everywhere. So here the first term 2 sin phi by 2 is here. Here 2 sin phi by 2 is here, 2 sin phi by 2 is here. So put this term at first because this is the common term, 2 sin phi by 2. So then sin omega t plus phi, then sin omega t plus 2 phi in this way. So this term we can write it, this term. This is the term, sin omega t, then sin omega t plus phi. This term, if you take the addition of all this, then in all the portion, 2 sin phi by 2 is there. So I have written 2 sin phi by 2. And what remains here? Sin omega t. Then in the second term, what is remains? What remains? If you put 2 sin phi by 2 outside, sin omega t plus?
Phi.
Say? Phi. Then in the next term, what remains? Sin?
2 phi.
Sin omega t plus? Plus 2 phi. So this is the common term, 2 sin phi by 2. This is the taking the summation. We are taking the sum of all these things. So in the right hand side, this is the common portion. So it is written like this. Then this is the bracketed term. Now the two terms on the left hand combine to, now we can write these two terms, that is cos omega t minus phi by 2 minus cos of omega t minus n minus 1 n minus, here this term equal to this, 2 sin omega t plus n minus 1 phi by 2 into sin n phi by 2. So right here, what is this term? This term, cos of a minus b. See how we are getting cos of a minus b minus cos of, actually a plus b, this is the, this sign will be plus here. Cos of omega t minus, this sign will be plus. Because you see here, cos of a minus b minus cos of a plus b. So here this will be plus sign. So I will correct it again and you will send to your group. So cos of omega t minus phi by 2 minus cos of omega t plus this term. So now this is the term 2 sin a sin b. What is sin a?
Omega t minus 5 by 2.
So just you, in this way you will get, so combining 2 and 3, what we will get? Sin omega t plus sin 5 by 2 plus sin of omega t plus n minus 1 into 5. That is equal to sin of n 5 by 2 by sin 5 by 2, then sin of omega t plus n minus 1 into 5 by 2. Now this is the expression sin omega t plus sin phi, omega t plus phi, that is equal to this thing. Now the total electric field then becomes, what is E equal to? This is the sum. Now total E equal to E 10 sin n phi by 2 by sin phi by 2.
Sir, class needs to.
देखिए Therefore, the intensity distribution on the screen due to the diffraction at single slit is I equal to I0 sine squared beta by beta square. So actually see here, this is the expression of intensity. So this is the field actually, E equal to what? A sine beta by beta, sine omega t plus beta. So what is the intensity here? It's square. Intensity is its square. So it is sine square beta by beta square. So I equal to what? I zero sine square beta by beta square. And what is I zero? This is a square, that is n square a square. It is the intensity at beta tends to zero. Now this is the expression of intensity, I equal to I zero sine square beta by beta square. So this is the intensity. Now condition of maxima and minima. So remember this one, E equal to, this is a very important expression, A sine beta by beta sine of omega t plus beta. Therefore the intensity distribution on the screen due to the diffraction at single slit is this. Now condition of maxima and minima, condition for principal maxima. When theta tends to zero, then beta equal to pi b sine theta by lambda, that tends to zero. Now limit beta tends to zero, sine beta by beta, that is equal to one. So from equation four, what I can write? We can write that if beta tends to zero, then I equal to I zero. So for principal maxima, actually I equal to I zero. Now condition of minima, the intensity I will be zero when beta equal to sine beta equal to zero. So for minima, you know, so this is the position of minima, this is the position of minima, this is the position of minima. And for minima, the intensity will be what? For minima, you can see the intensity will be zero. So this is the expression of intensity. What is the expression of intensity? I equal to I zero sine square beta by beta square. So when I will be zero, say, when I will be zero, when beta will be, say, remember this expression of intensity, I equal to I zero sine square beta by beta square. When I will be minimum, because at minima intensity is zero. So what will be the value of beta then?
Zero.
Zero. So the beta value is zero, or beta equal to plus minus m pi, where m equal to 1 to 3. So beta, actually the value of beta is pi b sine theta by lambda, that will be plus minus m pi. It may be zero. Sine beta here, when sine beta equal to zero, so it may be beta, we can write it as beta equal to plus minus m pi. So we can write the condition from here, b sine theta equal to plus minus m pi. This is the condition of minima. So what is the condition of maxima? The condition of principal maxima, that means this term, sine beta by beta, limit beta tends to zero, sine beta by beta, this is equal to one. So this portion is one. So I equal to what? I zero. So this is the condition of principal maxima. And what is the condition of minima? The condition of minima is that beta will be plus minus m pi. So remember this condition, beta will be plus minus m pi, so that sine beta will be zero. So sine beta will be zero for what? Beta equal to plus minus m pi, where m equal to 1, 2, 3 in this way. Now this is the expression of beta pi b sine theta by lambda. So this is the expression of beta pi b sine theta by lambda, that is equal to plus minus m pi. So b sine theta equal to plus minus m lambda. This is the condition of minima. Now secondary maxima. So principal maxima condition I have calculated. Now the minima condition, that is also given. Now this is the secondary maxima. Now the intensity expression, I equal to I zero sine square beta by beta square. So calculate di by d beta. Di by d beta, if you are calculate, you will get like this. So just differentiate. Now applying the theory of maxima and minima, we can write di by d beta equal to zero. So if di by d beta equal to zero, so put it zero. So this term is also zero. So either sine beta is zero, either sine beta is zero, or this term, this bracketed term is zero. Then if this bracketed term equal to zero, we can, from this we can write beta minus tan beta equal to zero, that is tan beta equal to beta. So we can write this expression. Now calculating d2i by d beta square and putting all these conditions, we get positive value of d2i by d beta square. For sine beta equal to zero, this supports the principle maxima and minima. And negative value, if we calculate d2i by d beta square, we actually I is here. So if I calculate d2i by d beta square, then negative value will get here for this, and this supports the secondary maxima. Now the graphical representation. Now tan beta and equal to beta. This is one graph. Tan beta equal to beta. This is beta equal to tan beta. This is the graph. This is the graph. Beta equal to tan beta. Y here. Y equal to tan beta. I have taken. This graph. It is a transcendental equation, and we solve it graphically. We plot y equal to tan beta. So we have written y equal to tan beta and y equal to beta. This is another graph. This is another line. Y equal to beta. Where these two graphs intersect each other, give the positions of secondary maxima. So this graph, where they are intersecting each other, this gives the position of secondary maxima. From the figure, it is clear that the intersections occur at beta equal to 1.43 pi. See, this is the position of beta, b equal to 1.43 pi. This is the position where it is in this is the graph. This is the graph. What is the name of this? Y equal to tan beta. This is the graph of y equal to tan beta. This is the graph. This is the graph y equal to tan beta. And what is the graph y equal to beta? This is the y equal to beta graph. So where it intersect? At this point. So at this point it intersect. So this is the point of intersection. So what is the value in x-axis? What is the value here in x-axis? This value? From this to this value, what is this value here in x-axis? Beta equal to what? 1 point, because beta is plotted along the x-axis. So beta equal to 1.43 pi. This is the value. So this is the point of intersection. Then another intersection, y equal to tan beta here. This is the graph, and y equal to beta, this is the straight line here. Now it intersect in this point. See the cursor. This is the point of intersection. So what is the x value here? Beta equal to 2.46 pi. So this is the value. Beta equal to 2.46 pi. So this is the value. This is the point of intersection. This is the value. Here also, this is the point of intersection. If I go in this direction, this is the value of beta. So in this way, different value of beta we will get. Now taking beta nearly equal to 0, 3 pi by 2, 5 pi by 2. For all practical purpose, we can find out the magnitude of the intensity of the principal maxima I0, secondary maxima I1, and the secondary maxima I2, and so on. So for the principal maxima, theta equal to 0. So for principal maxima, theta equal to, so beta equal to 0. So I equal to I0, this is the condition of principal maxima. For the first secondary maxima, beta equal to 3 pi by 2. So beta value is 3 pi by 2. If you put it here in this equation, then sine square 3 pi by 2, then 3 pi by 2 whole square. So we will get I0 by 22. So see here, this is the, if you calculate 1.43 pi and here 3 pi by 2. So round off, just approximately it is written 3 pi by 2. Approximately it is written 5 pi by 2. But beta equal to 0, that is the principal maxima. Now these are all secondary maxima having beta equal to 3 pi by 2. So this value and this value nearly equal to same. For easier calculation, it is written like this. So you can see actually this point, this peak is where? The cursor, where I am putting the cursor, where is the peak? Beta equal to, see, say beta equal to what? Original the cutting point, beta equal to 1.43 pi. But actually, but what I have actual point, but what point I have taken? This point, beta equal to C, this is 3 pi by 2. So in the place of 1.43 pi, I have written 3 pi by 2. See here, this is the first secondary maxima. So this is the first, so deviation is there, but for easier calculation, I'm just taking like this, 3 pi by 2. Then I have taken 5 pi by 2. But actually it is beta equal to this, but for easier calculation, I'm taking 5 pi by 2. So beta equal to 5 pi by 2 for secondary maxima. Now put it here, so it is I0 by 61. In this way, I3 will also get 7 pi by 2. So if you take the intensity ratio, you will get like this. So actually the time is over, actually 10, it is 11 and you have next class. So I'm not discussing more here. So ending my class, all of you send your Google form and tomorrow again, I will discuss if you have some difficulty in calculation, go through it. I will discuss again. Okay, so leaving the class.